Thousands of free and enslaved Africans that were hungry for a taste of freedom and a better life jumped at the opportunity to pursue it in the Revolutionary War, with multitudes of them fighting for both the American Patriots and British Loyalists. In 1776, slaves who were concentrated in the South comprised about one-sixth of the colonists' population and were socially inferior and treated with significantly more cruelty than other oppressed groups, such as white indentured servants, women, and wage laborers. Although a majority of blacks fought for the Patriots, a substantial number of them, largely runaway slaves, sided with the Loyalists. Thousands of enslaved and free Africans fought for the rebels. They served in the Continental Army or Navy, either as spies, servants, cooks, artisans, messengers, or as minutemen. In the North, about one-fifth of the army was composed of black soldiers. Meanwhile, one-tenth of the Continental Army as a whole was black, which is about 5,000 soldiers. Although plenty of slaves joined the rebels by choice, many were used by their masters as replacements when they or their sons got drafted into the army. Black soldiers were essential for the Patriots and fought bravely at Lexington and Concord and in the Battle of Bunker Hill, where a slave called Peter Salem earned his freedom along with a military pension by shooting the British commander, Major John Pitcairn. James Armistead Lafayette, a former slave, like Peter Salem, gained his freedom by working as a spy for the Patriots, obtaining secret information on the movements of the British troops, which led to the British defeat of Yorktown in 1786. Both sides discovered the importance of the Africans' contribution of much-needed manpower early on, yet they were both cautious and skeptical of incorporating them. This is shown on November 7, 1775, in the last royal governor of Virginia, John Murray's proclamation, in which he said,
"And I do hereby further declare all indentured servants, Negroes or others, appertaining to rebels, free that are able and willing to bear arms, they joining His Majesty's troops as soon as may be."
This sparked competition. General George Washington had formally stated that the cowardly and white superiority threatening blacks should not participate in the war, and now admitted that the side that armed the most Africans would be the victor, contradicting not only his own prior beliefs, but those of Congress as well. By December, 300 runaway slaves served in Lord Dunmore's Ethiopian regiment, all with liberty to slaves inscribed on their military uniforms. This made patriots very nervous and fearful, especially because the unit was most regularly put into action in the South, where slavery was most concentrated and severe. On the other hand, Rhode Island had been enlisting slaves since 1778, because they were unable to match the mandatory troop quotas of the Continental Congress. Stemming from General Varnum's idea, they created the 1st Rhode Island Regiment, that was led by white officers and had 225 men, 140 of whom were black. It declared that
"every able-bodied Negro, mulatto, or Indian manslave that chose to do so, and every slave so enlisting shall, upon his passing muster before Colonel Christopher Green, be immediately discharged from the service of his master or mistress and be absolutely free."
Following the recruitment of slaves, they would compensate the slave owners for their losses. This trade of service for freedom was also practiced by other states in New England, and though greatly frowned upon in the South due to their fear of slave rebellions, troop shortages posed a larger threat than the possible slave rebellion. As the last British ship left to England in July 1782, over 5,000 former slaves left for St. Augustine, the West Indies, and Jamaica. The British created a book, with the name of more than 3,000 blacks that participated in the war, called the Book of Negroes. Those whose name appeared in the book were authorized to go to Nova Scotia, London, and Western Africa in escaping bondage. Them keeping their word to the slaves outraged many slave owners and patriot leaders, and for that reason, an abundance did not remain free for long. As for the patriots, hundreds became free, especially in the North, and not much time passed before northern states abolished slavery altogether. Both free and enslaved Africans played various vital roles that significantly altered the course of the Revolutionary War.